Welcome to the Industry Angel Podcast. We hear from the best business minds across the globe. Entrepreneurs, social influencers, marketing mavens, and sales rock stars. We've got them all. Here comes your weekly dose of inspiration with your host, Ian Farrer.
Welcome to episode 207 of the Industry Angel. Great to be back. Thanks for listening once again. I've got a few shout outs to get round to. I've been meaning to do this for so long. Natasha McDonough, great for you to get in touch. And also pass our podcast on to Mark Edmondson. And that's how we grow, through referrals. So please, if you can, share the show with your friends. That's all we ask. It's free content. You could even drop us a review. Now that would be good. Mark Rowe, thank you. You've started following the podcast, full of good advice. Thanks for that, Mark. Claire Proctor, PhD student. Claire's recently found the show and asked that I'd give her a shout out. So thanks for getting in touch, Claire. And Suzanne Foster, the owner of the Gentle Bee Company. Hi, Suzanne. Thanks for getting in touch once again. I remember you were on one of my talks at Newcastle University. So it's great to hear from you. So as all those lovely people have done, drop me a line, keep in touch. I'm all over Twitter. It's my favorite, isn't it? So Ian_Farrer, or you can get in touch via industryangel.com. Okay then, so today's guest is one of our International Women's Day guests. She was the first guest of that day, and she was also the first guest on Industry Angel. Let's hear from Dinah Bennett.
Welcome to the show, Dinah, for the second time.
Good morning. It's great to be here. I'm really privileged to join the stellar lineup you've got. So thank you.
A total stellar lineup. I'm trying to read your introduction here, and I got a bit mixed up, because you know what it is. There's so much I could say about you, Dinah. This doesn't do it justice. You know, you are one of the most motivational women I've ever met, to be honest, and that's why you were the first person I ever had on my podcast. Because all those years ago when we met, I was just blown away by some of the stuff that you do in lots of different countries. And you must have spoke to thousands and thousands over the years and just inspired so many. So I want you to give me an introduction rather than this one. Who are you, Dinah? What do you do?
I'm blushing. Thanks for the introduction. I'm Dinah Bennett. I run my own company, which is International Consultants for Entrepreneurship and Enterprise. And I'm also the global lead for enterprise development at the Women's Economic Imperative, which is a fantastic organization that actually came out of a UN high-level panel for women's economic empowerment. And it's just working globally, looking at all the sort of intersectionalities to ensure that women are able to be economically empowered. So it's a real privilege to be working with them. And our CEO, Dr. Margot Thomas, is one of the most inspirational women you could ever come across. In fact, she'd actually make a great podcast guest for your series, Ian. So I'd highly recommend that. And it just seems such a long time ago since I did my first podcast with you. Congratulations on having 200 plus. It's fantastic.
Yeah, it must be about 6 years ago now. It's a long, long time. And for anybody who doesn't know you, they might have heard that sentence or two that you've said there, but still not really understand. So tell me a couple of examples, Dinah, of women that you've worked with, or women, or some projects that you work with, and some of the companies that you've also worked in, and maybe some stories of change.
Well, I've been privileged to work, I think, in every single continent. I think I haven't actually counted how many countries, but as my company suggests, international consultants, I do work overseas. I mean, the current projects I'm working on at the moment, one for the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development in Central Asia, working in Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, looking at the policy and regulation framework in those countries and how they can impact both either positively or negatively on women thinking of starting and growing businesses. So that's current. And we do see policies are a big issue, which is why when I talk about my challenge, choosing to challenge, I want to call out policies that hinders women's economic development or enterprise development, because often policies are actually made by policymakers that have no understanding of what goes on at grassroots level, let alone how that impacts on issues of gender. Another project I'm currently working on is a business startup and growth program for women entrepreneurs in Libya. I actually won that contract during lockdown. It's really tricky sometimes doing everything online because to me, so much of the work that I do is the joy of meeting people and interacting with them. And it's slightly trickier, as we all know, online. But hopefully with the vaccines, you know, we're sort of slowly coming out of this. So as well as doing those projects, my company, I work on behalf of Women's Economic Imperative. And last year I was co-chair of one of the task forces of the T20, which is the Think 20, the think tank of the G20 countries. So Saudi Arabia had the presidency last year and Italy has the presidency this year. I'm currently working on some new policy briefs, but my role on behalf of the Women's Economic Imperative is to make sure that gender is featured. And sometimes when reviewing some of the policy briefs, it's really tricky just to get gender as a footnote. So if we're not getting gender on the agenda, it's not going to be addressed. So it's really quite important and work that I really, really enjoy. Obviously, I've got loads of projects close to home as well. I work with colleagues at Newcastle University, Nicholas Patterson. We co-founded Gender and Entrepreneurship Northeast. And in fact, you came to one of our scoping meetings at Durham University. And so that's looking at the sort of meso macro level as to how we can actually affect change within the system to support more gender equal or equity in terms of people who wish to start and run a business in this region, which is actually really exciting.
It is. And even just let's talk about close to home for the moment, that project you've done there. What are some of the outputs from that? What has happened? What are the outcomes from some of that work where you've got together with stakeholders, you've tried to map it out and see what we need? What was actually the outcome?
Well, we have a whole variety of different sort of activities that we're involved in. And we've got a fantastic advisory board from people around the region, either those running their businesses or in business support. And one of the things that we did was working with the Women's Enterprise Policy Group, a national organisation. We actually challenged the Chancellor in terms of some of the lockdown or the COVID strategies that have come out that are really impacting, you know, badly against women in the main. And one thing, as we all know, that COVID has done has really highlighted and brought to the fore the disparities that we see and how women in particular, and particularly the Black and minority ethnic community running businesses, you know, have been hardest hit. So it's really calling things out and highlighting some of these issues so that something can be done about it. I think it's really important. So, yes, I'm really pleased to be working on that. I mean, I'm very passionate about, you know, the Northeast region, as you know. And, you know, I feel that I can't possibly work internationally without doing something where I live, you know, grassroots.
It must be really exciting for you because you will go to, I don't know, some developing countries as well. And you'll see, is there a theme, Dinah? Are there themes that when you see you go to many countries around the world, is there a theme that you come across quite often?
When you say a theme, you mean in relation to gender?
Women in entrepreneurship, really, I was thinking about that.
Oh, yes. Wherever I work, to me, it's the sort of like similar threads that I see in every country with some additional sort of contextual ones. So it's the perception of women in many countries as to what their role should be. Women shouldn't be running a business. Women shouldn't be sticking their head above the parapet. They should be at home looking after children. And in some of my studies and work, I'm told this, you know, so we don't want women to run businesses. The issue of fragmented credit histories, when I'm working with bankers, I do a lot of training with bankers around the world. Okay. And they say to me, but Dinah, I treat men and women the same when they come to me. And I'm saying, that's the problem. Because women do have a fragmented credit history. They've had to take time off work. So we're not, you know, starting from a level playing field. But also it's the nature of multitasking often of women that they will run actually maybe two or three part-time jobs with that inkling of an idea to start a business. And research conducted by Project Northeast many years ago found that from an inkling of an idea for a woman to start a business to jumping into it full time can sometimes take up to 7 years. Sometimes it could take a lot shorter. I mean, I must stress that women are not a homogeneous group. So when I'm talking about women, we must understand the heterogeneous nature of them. But some things do take a lot longer because initially childcare, you know, that women do have to juggle that and put their family first. So yes, very, very similar themes. So the perception barrier, I think, is quite important that women don't do this. And we're seeing this quite clearly in women in the STEM sectors. Because there are so few role models there, women actually believe in themselves. They think, well, maybe I can't do it. And other people say, well, no one else has done it before as a woman, so why should you be able to? So there are the perceptual barriers. And to me, those are the invisible ones. And they're harder to crack, really, you know, because they're quite hidden. We've talked about access to finance. In many developing countries, the whole issue of sanitary protection. Girls miss weeks of school because of no sanitary protection. And we're seeing some fantastic schemes springing up now to ensure that they don't have to miss their education. Because once you miss a whole chunk of education, that's the platform for you going forward. And again, where's the equity there? They're always starting on a back foot. So a whole host of different things, but some common themes.
It's really interesting. You know, you talked a little bit there about policies and calling out policies.
Yeah.
How does that process work? You know, sometimes people might feel a certain way about a policy that, you know, that I'm trying to I guess Twitter and the likes of things that are where people will take to social media and they'll say something, Dinah, that they don't agree with, and they'll blurt it out, and that's it. What can you actually do to say what you've just said there, to call out policies, to make a change, to challenge what we're talking about today? How can people impact that then, rather than just sort of taking a social and saying, I disagree with this? You know, what is the real impact that people can make?
That's a really interesting question, Ian. And people will often say to me, gosh, I feel so helpless. I'm just in a minority. I can't do anything. And I love that phrase of anyone that felt they were too small to do anything has never spent the night with a mosquito, you know. And I just think that's sort of quite a great analogy. But I will say, well, join a group, you know, find your tribe, find people that think the same way as you. You know, you can actively, there are all party parliamentary groups that one can join. One of my bugbears was that when one looked at the composition of these all party parliamentary groups, they were so southern centric. And I was told it's because we can't afford to pay for people to come down. And I said, well, many people would actually pay for themselves. But the interesting thing now is, now we've gone online, many of the poll party parliamentary groups are online and anyone from anywhere in the country can join. So I hope that when we go back, we can still hear voices from around the country to contribute their stories. I do think you should join different groups and associations and really get your voice heard. I mean, you talk about social media. I mean, I am very wary of social media because, you know, some of the negativity, you know, that is sort of spewed out on it. And I don't find that very, very positive or helpful. But I feel that if you want people to understand your story, coming from a measured perspective, and it's almost like marketing, isn't it? You know, sort of inbound marketing, go to where people will read things and make a really measured comment and talk about the reasons why. I mean, I mentioned earlier when we talk about policy, policy is often made by people that don't have the understanding of grassroots, which is why when there's a whole consultation process, we need to get people involved. You know, this whole eat out to help out scheme, as far as I was concerned, it helped big businesses, not the smaller, not the SMEs, to be honest, in the main. Why was that? You know, and we're always talking that SMEs are the backbone of any country. Well, why isn't enough being done to understand them and their needs when policy is being formulated? You know, we used to have small firms, but we don't anymore. Why is that? I just don't think there are enough people at the table to understand the issues. And that's another reason why we're calling for more women to actually be called, not just to sort of C-suites, to different committees so their voices can be heard.
How do you promote that, Dinah? So how do you get out there and be a voice to promote that? Is it that you need ambassadors, you know, people to step up and share their story and promote? Is that the answer?
I think sharing stories is actually quite powerful and role model. I remember when I used to work on Women Into the Network, gosh, that set that up 21 years ago. That was in response to the fact that I was doing research at Durham Business School to look at what made successful small businesses. And try as I might, I could only find two women to go into my research study.
Wow.
Where were they? Don't women run businesses? I mean, a lot has changed now, which is fantastic. But you know, I kept digging to find out what was going on here. And one of the things that came out of the research was that relationships and networking was one of the most powerful business development tools. So I started looking at what was going on in the region, and I found out that there were 700 different networks and support organizations that should a woman wish to join, she could. And it was going from either mainstream, so the CBI, the Chamber, Federation of Small Business, to either sort of like, you know, specifically targeted networks, you know. And a lot of women networks could, you know, it could have been like childcare, mother, you know, parent and baby clubs or whatever, child clubs. But when I spoke to women about mainstream business events, they said, I would go, but the timing's all wrong for me. And they're always at a fixed time when I have to actually do the sort of like, you know, domestic or childcare. Or I do go to some of them, but I'm actually treated like somebody's secretary. I'm not treated as a businesswoman in my own right. And that's why I felt to sort of level up, we needed something that did treat women as businesswomen or aspirant businesswomen and catered to their needs. And we listened to what they said. And we had events from early in the morning to sometimes late at night. Mm-hmm. The women would choose its choice, which was best suited to them. Where these events were held were really important as well, because it could be quite intimidating sometimes, or to drive somewhere far away to go to a four-star hotel. So we ran a range of events in different venues, community centres. We also ran them in five-star hotels too, of course we did. It was very important, and it goes back to the heterogeneity of the women's market. We're not all the same. And indeed, many women would say to me, don't even talk to me about childcare. If a woman can't sort out her childcare when she's thinking of setting up and running a business, she shouldn't be doing it. So, you know, a lot of different sort of like views and perspectives, but it's understanding that nature and that diversity. And that's what makes it so vibrant. So join clubs, join networks, read, you know, read things or read papers or magazines. Listen to podcasts that Industry Hazel puts on. Get on there and comment. Have your say and become more visible. I think it's really important. I think, you know, women that have something to say should be made more visible. And I think sometimes the media, the press is sometimes a bit guilty of this. They will pick sort of half a dozen women in the region or any region, I'm not just saying Northeast, that are quite vocal. And they'll always be the same old. And I think what we should be doing is digging a lot deeper and looking a little harder to get different voices.
I love that. I'm going to take that. I'm going to create a little promo video for 30 seconds, which I'll push out there, because that is perfect. And we see that on a grander scale, Dinah. We see the Jeff Bezos, the Steve Jobs, you know, these people punted out all the time. And it's lazy journalism, and it's actually lazy storytelling, because there's so many people out there doing amazing stuff. And even today, we've got Jules on, who's on at 11:50. Jules has never done a podcast, never done any live stuff, never spoke. She's been saying how she's nervous and stuff. She is amazing. 25 years in business in the region, but doesn't tell anybody. And this is a platform to do that. And I want more people to do that and share, because we are punting the same people over and over again, and we punt the same people, we hear the same rhetoric, and nothing changes. We need new, fresh ideas.
You're so right, and good for Jules. I think that's brilliant, you know, that she's doing this with you. And also, but your podcasts are fantastic, the diversity of the people and the opinions that you have there. I think it's really, really important, and not the same old, same old. I remember I worked really closely with this fantastic journalist at the journal on the business pages. I explained to her, and she was, I'll name her, Rebecca Ashby. She does deserve a shout out. She was fantastic. I don't think she's in journalism anymore. She was always willing to learn and wanted to know why we were doing the things that we were doing. And I explained to her that I used to get really cross that I'd only seen articles about women on the women's pages. And that's not right. When we're talking about women doing business, I want to see them on the women's pages. So we had an agreement that if I fed her stories of women doing business in this region, she would undertake to get one in every single day on the business pages. And she did that. And what a difference that made, because women were seen to be doing business and talked about, you know, all the issues around that. And it did make a huge difference. And I think our region for women-owned business is pretty vibrant, actually, you know. So, yes, raise the profile of lots of different types of women. That's exactly what you're doing.
You mentioned that they said, you know, women are not visible or they haven't been, is it because there hasn't been other women visible, so then they think that they shouldn't be? So when we are, this is getting a bit complicated, when we show people, when we give women a platform, is it that they feel inspired to then feel that they can then step forward, Dinah? How does that work?
I think it's a mixture of different things. Mm. Sometimes it's women that have a lot of confidence, but mm-hmm. sometimes are really sort of like not saying things that other women can relate to. Okay. So I would like the idea that you've got this woman, she's running a business for 25 years, never been on, you know, media or done an interview. I think that's wonderful. I bet she has an awful lot to say. And it's partly a confidence thing. And I always say to women, if you're nervous about doing something, just do it. What's the worst thing that can happen, really? But also, it's offering a sort of coaching facility. I remember when I first did that podcast with you, I think it was one of the first podcasts I'd done. You were brilliant. You know, you set it up, you coached me, Ian, saying, you know, this is what I'll expect. We'll just have, you know, talk about X, Y, and Z. And it made such a difference. So I think a lot more women could come forward and get support. One of the things that we're just about to set up is something called Articulate Women. And it's actually getting more women's voices heard. But not only that, it's actually getting women that have something to say that said, oh, I can't do that, or I really don't want to do that. But then coaching them to enable them to do that. And I think that's really, really important to actually get that the diversity of women's voices. So I think fear of, you know, being silly. I mean, gosh, honestly, I've learned so much from sort of like making massive mistakes and being silly. But I keep saying, well, what's the worst thing that can happen? You know, if something I've said can inspire just one woman to do something differently. And I mean, I'm terrified. You know, I contacted you days ago saying, oh, you know, I've not done this for a long time, but I must say, you do make it very easy, Ian, and it's great to be here. So don't hold yourself back, I say.
Not at all. And you know, before I press that red button, you do get a bit of nerves because you're going live and it's on there, it's on the internet. But I think you wouldn't be human if you didn't have those nerves. And yes. That just shows how much that it means to you that you do feel that way, because you want it to be good and you want to inspire and you want to share great content. Something you said 5 minutes or so ago, Dinah, was that you started, I think it was Women in Network was the term.
Women into the Network, yeah.
Women into the Network, that was 21 years ago, Dinah.
Yeah.
Have you saw a positive change in those 21 years?
Oh, massive. I mean, I sort of left it 10 years ago in good hands. And I think the awards ceremonies are still going. And I've seen massive changes. And the thing that I really regret not doing is a study of all the women that were shortlisted for our awards. And I was very, very conscious that I didn't want to set up yet another awards ceremony, Ian, you know, because to me that sort of dilutes what you're doing sometimes when there are too many of them. But I was urged to do this because the awards that we had in the region were called Businessman of the Year Businessman of the Year. So I challenged the journal saying, well, why are you calling it Businessman of the Year? He said, because it's for businessmen, it's men that do business. And I said, all right, okay. And a lot of my academic male colleagues said, but that's the generic term, isn't it, for someone that does business? I said, no, if I'm a woman doing business, I'm a businesswoman, not a businessman. And language, visual imagery are incredibly important.
Yeah.
So I worked with a journal and they told me that only 4% of nominations came from women. I think in 1999 or 1998, a woman won the award, but then she was called Businessman of the Year. And I was saying, well, what is that message that's been given out to other aspirant businesswomen? So I decided to set up Women Entrepreneur of the Year. Now, another organisation in London had just set up some awards and they were naming them in Greek goddesses. Now, I have a lot of respect for that organisation and a lot of respect for the Greek goddesses. But I thought, why name Women's Business Awards in the name of Greek goddesses? You may as well name them in Disney characters, right? Women who do business in a whole range of different sectors. And I want that, you know, raised to the fore.
Yeah.
So our categories were women in manufacturing, women in social enterprise, women, you know, in different sectors, best startup, you know, in the whole sort of shebang. And what was amazing, I also set up, in terms of our governance structure, a really amazing judging panel. I mean, everything was done above board. It wasn't a case of, oh, she looks good, let's have her. it was done in a very, very meticulous way and thorough way, because I felt that was so important. Because as a women's organisation, setting something like that up, it could be viewed as being diminutive, really. It doesn't really count. So, and all the women that were shortlisted, you could actually chart their trajectory as to the national and international awards they then went on to win. It was quite remarkable, actually. As I say, that's only anecdotal, but I could still do a study to look at that. So it's putting women on that platform to inspire others to recognise them. The other rule that we had was, for all the sponsors, was that you weren't allowed to talk for more than a minute. You know, when you go to these award ceremonies and the sponsor will talk for 5 minutes and you're thinking, yeah, what's this about? We put the women at the forefront. So she spoke, these women spoke about their businesses and what they do. And to me, what it was an educational process to those in the audience. It was great. In fact, our tickets used to sell out way in advance. You know, we never had a problem of selling tickets. So it was a two-way educational process. It was fantastic. So yes, I think that's really important, is give women a platform, create platforms that other people can see. So, you know, they become the role models and inspire others. Sorry, talking too much.
No, I love that. I love that. I listen all day. Before you do leave us, I do love your stories, Dinah, and I do love to travel off into other places and hear inspirational stuff. A country that's close to my heart is India, and I know you've done some work in some countries and work with some inspirational women. I love your stories. Can I have a couple of stories from you?
I go to India for the last 20 years. I go to India every year, and I work with an NGO called Sampark. And Sampark's based in Bangalore, and it does the most phenomenal work. And this small team at Sampark over the years have economically empowered over 75,000 women in the poorest areas of Karnataka and Varanasi by setting up really small savings groups with groups of women. It's phenomenal. And they can just come in every couple of weeks and, put in the pot 5 rupees, 10 rupees, you know, very small amounts. And these women have gone on to build businesses over the years. And it's so small. I want to sing the praises of its founder, Dr. Smita Premchanda, and her amazing team, because the work she is doing is so transformational. It really is. I'm a trustee. I work with an amazing guy called Mike Amaya, and he works in the largest slum in East Africa. And what he does, he's a dancer, actually, but he's very, very entrepreneurial. So he was brought up in Kibera, the slum. He sets up dance classes. So I've been to his dance classes for these young children that live in the slums, boys and girls. And, you know, working with Dance Center Kenya, an amazing woman called Cooper Rust, they have taken children, young people from the slums, and they have gotten scholarships. Well, they haven't got them. They've been awarded scholarships because they're so talented, at the Royal Ballet School in London, Copenhagen, in the States. So these stories, honestly, just talking about it, the hairs on the back of my neck, you know, talk about it. But Mike has also set up, he's doing a lot of enterprise education with the schools in the slums there, but he's set up free sanitary protection program. So young girls can just be texted from local stores within Kibera to get the sanitary protection that they need to enable them to continue to go to school. Because that's one big thing all over the world with young girls, as I mentioned earlier. They lose days, weeks, months from education because of lack of sanitary protection. That shouldn't happen to any young girl, you know? So, you know, two examples. But, I mean, I'm so privileged to work in the area that I'm working and with the people that I'm working. I just love it, you know? And I'm seeing change, but we still have a long way to go. I mean, all the work that we do at the T20 and the G20 is looking at the Sustainable Development Goals. And the headline there is leave no one behind. And that's really important. Yep. Leave no one behind. And I think that's really what we're trying to do, you know, make sure that everyone is coming with us.
I love those stories, and that's why I asked you to share them. And I know, you know what else I love? The photographs. Some of the photographs that I've seen you win, and the women that wear them, traditional wears and bright colours, and you're in amongst them, and they're smiling, and you know, it must just be so rewarding for you, Dinah. I need to come on a mission with you next time. You need to bring me along with you, because it looks so amazing, and it must be just, you must learn as well, Dinah. You know, this is not You know, this is very much into your way street, isn't it?
Of course. I learn so much from the people I work with. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important. I'm not taking knowledge to these people. I am learning from them. And things that I learn in sub-Saharan Africa, in India, in China, I bring back, you know, and share with people in the north. So it's not the north going to the south. It's you know, it's a two-way street, as you say.
Yeah.
Learning from each other. It's just fantastic. And I'd love you to come on a trip. I can imagine all the podcasts that you could do with all the people that you meet.
I know. Places. Just an audio recorder, just capturing content, that would be an absolute dream. And some of the inspiration from innovation, you know, when there's little resource there, the innovation that pops out is just remarkable sometimes. I bet you've seen so many little hacks and innovative businesses.
Well, I think it does bring to life, what's that phrase? Necessity is the mother of invention, really. Yeah. You know, and people that have so little, and it just makes me very conscious about, you know, living in the West, living in a developed economy, how much we have, but how little we appreciate sometimes, you know? And it's almost like, you know, becoming grounded and realizing, do we need all this, really? You know, and I think COVID's actually given a lot of food for thought, hasn't it? For a number of reasons. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a terrible thing that's happened, but I'd like to think that some positivity comes out of it by making us think about the whole issue of vaccine equity. No one is safe until we're all safe. So we really do need to push to ensure that other people are vaccinated as well as ourselves.
Well, Dinah, that's a lovely place to leave it. And thank you so much for sharing your stories. I love that. I can listen to you all day. And so can everybody else. Look, here's Carolyn there.
You're very kind. Thanks for having me on. I'm looking forward to hearing everybody else. Keep up the great work.
There's our Deb.
Hi, Deb. And so, happy International Women's Day.
Thank you so much, Diane. Let's not leave it as long next time.
No,
and
my pleasure.
Thank you so much for all the amazing work you're doing.
Thank you for having
Thanks,
me.
Thanks, Diana.
Bye.
There you go. That's our Diana from episode 1, 6 years ago. And there she comes back for another fantastic interview.
That was our Diana there. Wonderful once again. I am desperate to go on a mission with Diana and watch her at work because she is so inspiring. And that's why she was episode number 1, but now she's the member of the 2 Timers Club. So thanks, Dinah. Lovely to hear from you once again and to inspire the audience. Again, remember, get in touch. Let me know how this has been for you. And I look forward to speaking with you very soon. I'm Ian Farrer. This is The Industry Angel. And thanks for listening.